Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Power up and spread the light. It's Monday night. Keith Anthony Blanchard, your host here of Center of Light Radio. As always, strap in all ye spiritual astronauts as we launch for inner space. Center of Light Radio is expanding. I'm adding a newsletter. It's going to happen once a month, at least for now, I'm thinking once a month, starting January 1st. It's one of those things where you just put in your email address and you get every issue that I put out just like that, just like clockwork. No trouble to you. Also, make sure when you go to centeroflightradio.com, you check out my movie I put out about a month or so ago. Woke up one morning and had this wild idea to make a movie. It's called And the Meek Shall Inherit the Earth, The Prophecy Realized. Check it out. Go to centeroflightradio.com. At the very top of the page, you'll see a movie banner. Just click on it and you are good to go. Also, on the same website, you're going to find Do What You Love Forever course. It's all electronic downloads and also streaming video-wise. $5, $4.99 actually. And we're running a special to the end of the year. Check that out. This is what you get. You get my bestseller, The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, self-reflection workbook to encourage your spiritual development, divine daily supplements, Do What You Love, A Path to Passionate Living, a movie made about my life with new Blue Cast Productions out of New York. Phenomenal movie, actually. It's very, very good, but it's all about the tools that I hand you to empower you so you can beat your feet towards your bliss. You do not have to have a 9-to-5 job grind. 9-to-5 is good if you're doing what you love, but if it's a grind and you're not happy, that unhappiness kind of filters through the family unit. Next thing you know, the household is not happy. So you can lift up that family vibration by at least moving into the window of your passion. Let me help you do that. Check out the Do What You Love Forever course. Also, you get, I love saying this, the Divine Principle audiobook multimedia music album. It's an audiobook read by yours truly. I insert Lavender Soul, the music you heard on the intro of the show, but also the song before the show, is Lavender Soul, my spiritual group with members of the Memphis Symphony Orchestra, layered under all the narration of my bestseller, The Divine Principle. Also, you get the Anchoring Heaven on Earth audio meditation. Best way to power up and boot your life up so you can hear the guidance of spirit and shape miles off of your spiritual journey. To call into the show, I got a great guest tonight. This is going to be a wild ride, let me tell you. The number you dial is 888-919-2355, 888-919-2355. Remember, if you're not at home by your computer and you want to hear your favorite show, hopefully it's Center of Light or any of the fine shows you find here in Inception Radio Network, you can go to the App Store on your phone and download the Inception Radio Network app for free. Everything is right there at your fingertips. Chat room, listen, live link, news, podcasts, much more. There are many ways to connect to Center of Light Radio and Inception Radio Network for sure. And now, big drum roll, it's time to get down to Center of Light Radio business. Tonight, my guest is Mr. Gavin Davies, worldwide best-selling author, and we will shed light on a most haunted house in ghost sex, The Violation. Tell you about my guest. Gavin Davies created the Paranormal Chronicles in October 2013 and became sole owner of Pembrokeshire, I got to say it correctly, not Shire, Shire, Beyond in January 2015, born in 1975, Mr. Davies lives in Pembrokeshire, West Wales. He studied hauntings in the 19th century literature and has spent most of his career in advertising. He has also studied cobbling, watch repairing, and hairdressing. He won ITV's six-part series TV series Natural Born Sellers in 2008 and featured on the Harry Hill TV Burp show. Burps, you love it. His passion always been for the paranormal and has spent years listening and collating local ghost stories and myths. He says he is still on the fence in terms of his beliefs, but has witnessed many strange occurrences in his life, but prefers to travel the psychological and rational route before making any assumptions, smart man. He respects the views of all on the subject, saying that no person alive has the knowledge and understanding of time, space, and intricacies of the human mind to be so sure on anything to do with the paranormal. There's more to his bio. Trust me, it's all juicy, good stuff. Let's bring my guest, Mr. Gavin Davies, to Center of Light Radio. Welcome to this Center of Light Radio show, sir.
Good evening, Keith. What an introduction. Thank you very much. I feel humbled and honored to be on your show. Thank you. How are you this evening?
I am fantabulous, brother. I'm glad you are here. I'm excited about the show. I have not yet in my short radio career, 3 years, maybe 3.5 years, done anything on the paranormal in this regard. How do you want to start this thing off, sir?
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you and all your listeners for tonight's opportunity. And I would just like to reach out to everyone from the Paranormal Chronicles that is listening tonight, all the followers. Please, please go on the Center of Light website. There's a fantastic archive. There's a wealth of information on there. You'd be doing yourself a disservice not to go on and have a look at all your great archives, all your great podcasts, all your links. Amazing, amazing library of information there. So thank you very much for having me on the show. And I promise for all your readers and listeners out there, it won't be too offensive when we talk about the ghost sex phenomenon. I will keep it PG for you, sir. So no one has to put the children to bed quite yet.
I had my mic on mute. I had a little coughing spell. Well, thank you. Thank you for the support about the Center of Light Radio and the archives and all the work that I put into it. I love what I do. I wake up every day looking for something to create. And so my passion is in all of it. Gavin, throughout my life, I have had experiences of the paranormal. Definitely not. We're not speaking the metaphysical. We're talking strictly ghost kinds of subjects here for the listening audience. And by the way, listening audience, welcome to Center of Light Radio. It's always a blessing and a pleasure to see you there. I'm sure of it. At least I'm sure, Gavin, of what I've experienced to be, as you said, this something's amiss here. Something is not normal. Tell me about some of the experiences. How did you get into this? What made you decide to start working in the field of paranormal?
When I was 4 years old, myself and my parents were living in an old converted mill. It'd been converted, so it was a house, and we lived there. And we lived there with some friends. My father was RAF, Royal Air Force, and we travelled around the country for a bit. But that was our base, that was our home. And when I was 4 years old, I had an imaginary friend. And I used to have conversations with...
Okay, hang on, Gavin. Let me ask you right here, right now. I don't mean politely walk on your toes. You had an imaginary friend. Please tell me what that was like. Did you see him? Did you hear him? Or was it just a fanciful idea in your head? Or were you convinced that you had another with you?
I can't remember much about this, but he was a very jolly figure. I used to describe him as having a waistcoat, and he had a top hat, and he used to smoke a pipe. And, you know, I used to chase him around the house. I'd be chatting to him. My parents and their friends thought he was literally just an imaginary friend. However, one night they were sat at the dining table. This was been about 1979 when I was four. They were sat around the table. I was long in bed. And they smelt tobacco. They smelt pipe smoke. And in the corner, just faintly materialized, was the figure of a gentleman in a top hat, in a waistcoat. And then he dematerialized. And they were shocked. And they did some research. And it turned out there was a Victorian gambler was said to haunt the mill. And he was quite an agreeable chap. I don't ever remember being frightened or anything of that nature. But it was a story that always came up about like who was Gavin's imaginary friend. So when I was 11 in school, our teacher read us a book on a sunny Friday afternoon, a book called The Uninvited. Now, it was quite a departure from the usual Roald Dahl books and C.S. Lewis that we were accustomed to at that stage. And the book, The Uninvited, was about a UFO phenomenon, a happening that happened in my county of Pembrokeshire. Very well pronounced at the top of the show as well, sir, in Pembrokeshire. And it happened in the late 1970s, early 80s. But it was terrifying. It was absolutely awful what this family were forced to endure with these alien beings allegedly doing all kinds of terrible things to them. So I went home that night absolutely terrified. I was really scared. It was like such a berserk subject to talk to children of 10 and 11 years old. I'm not quite sure to this day why my teacher did, but I'm glad she did. So I went home and I was terrified and I couldn't sleep. And my dad came in to see me and he said, "What's up? I understand you're upset." And I said, "Yeah, the miss read us this book and it was really scary about aliens doing these terrible things to his family, literally 5 miles from where I live." And he said, "Look," he said, "have you ever seen a ghost?" And I said, "Well, maybe, you know, this guy, this gambling guy I saw when I was four." And he said, "Did it harm you?" And I was like, "No, not at all." He said, "It was good, wasn't it?" I said, "Yeah." And he said, have you ever seen a UFO?" And me and my father believed we saw this UFO traveling through some clouds in a very erratic fashion a few years before. And he said, "Did that hurt us?" And I was like, "No." And he said to me, "Don't worry about the field of the paranormal." He said, "It's a wonderful subject to explore and delve." And he said, "If there is life after death, if there are other realms, if there is alien life, how exciting would that make life?" He said, "It'd be fantastic." He said, "It's the living we should fear. It's the living that will let you down and do you the most harm." He said, "All these other stuff is good." And so I went from being really frightened to being exceptionally curious and inquisitive about this. And I remember the next day I got a book called Arthur C. Clarke's Mysterious World, which is all about the paranormal. And then I bought a book called Photographs of the Unknown. And then I started reading up on literature, like M.R. James, you know, classic ghost literature. And that was it. I was hooked on the subject. And a few months later, there was an old abandoned ruin about a mile from my house. And some younger lads said they'd seen the mysterious white lady run through the brambles and they were terrified. So myself and another young lad, we jumped on our BMX bikes and we cycled down and I conducted my first ever investigation. And what we saw was a piece of tarpaulin, a piece of plastic was trapped in the bush, in the brambles. But to a hyper-suggestive imagination, these young boys had thought they'd seen a white lady. So that's when I started thinking, how much of this is fact? How much of this is suggestion? And how much of this is just, you know, rational explanations? And that's how I began my 30-odd year career in the paranormal.
A Most Haunted House, was this your first release?
That was my first book. I published that in October 2013.
Is this a collection of stories, your experiences, or a collection of stories of other people? Or what is the premise here?
Well, Most Haunted House is very interested because I wrote the book while I was commuting back and forth to work. It was a very prolific ghost story. And I wrote it as an investigator interviewing the inhabitants, the occupants of a house that had a very prolific haunting. Now, I published the book as a true account, but I changed the names of the people to protect their identity. However, there was a big reveal this year in a few major British magazines and on radio interviews that it was actually the house I lived in, and it was based on my own experiences. So when you read A Most Haunted House, the character of John is actually me, because people always said, well, it's very in-depth emotionally how these characters fared. And I said, because it was me. So the premise of the book is, I lived in a house about 15 years ago. I moved in with a girl who I was settling down with. And the house started with those almost unnoticeable, mundane incidents of things going missing, things not where they should be, cold spots, feelings. And it escalated. Now, at the time, I had a dependency or grew to have a dependency with alcohol, which may or may not have been accountable for some of the incidents. But other people were involved as well. So I wrote this true account. It was very personal to me. I didn't expect anybody to read it. I didn't expect it to do what it did. And 2 years later, over 35,000 copies have been read. It's had excellent reviews. I've been blessed with the feedback. You can read it from either the perspective of this is a haunting, or it's just a story of a relationship between two people collapsing and how they deal with that. Because people have to weigh up, is the haunting there because of the relationship collapsing, or is the relationship collapsing causing the haunting? And that was the nature of the book. It's done phenomenally well, and I'm so blessed that people have reached out and read it. And from the basis of that book, the Paranormal Chronicles grew. People were contacting me, because we talk about demons all the time. We talk about people facing their demons, being challenged by the demons, and we kind of just think of demons as a weakness, in terms of, oh, somebody is not strong enough to cope with a dependency with drugs, alcohol, women, right, gambling, whatever it is. But what I look at in the book is, what if these demons are actually real? What if something that we can't understand, something we can't comprehend, is actually latching onto us, causing depression, that it thrives on people's misery and despair? It thrives on taking something as beautiful as a couple's love for each other, dissolving and disintegrating until they become enemies and foes, rather than those people that were drawn together. And that's one of the themes of the book. So it's not your traditional, and he walked into a room and there was blood coming out the walls. It's not like that at all. If you're looking for sensationalized paranormal fiction or horror, this is not the book. It is the witness account of the people involved at the time, including myself. It's done in testimonial fashion, so it's presented as an interview. It's a lot different from a lot of the books out there. You get the thoughts, feelings of the people, as well as what they claim to be witnessing. So yes, it's an interesting read if you're into that. If you own a Kindle and you're a Prime member, you can just download it for free. You know, just have a go. And if you like it, great. If it interests you, please email me. Go to theparanormalchronicles.com, message me and tell me what you think, what your theories are. If you've had a similar experience, let me know. But what we've got to think is, all these relationships are break up. You know, the marriages, relationships between parents and their children, and vice versa, friendships dissolving. What if, I'm not saying it is true, but what if there is some kind of darker, more sinister, insidious element latching onto lives and feeding, being fueled by that despair and that negative energy? What if it is that?
Yeah, Ryder, what is your thoughts about, how, from your work and your experience, how much percentage-wise would you say is actual presence of a negative force, but also how much would be the manifestation of an imbalanced psyche?
For me, it's very difficult. I work very closely with a wonderful young lady called Karen Williams. She offers spiritual advice and guidance to anybody who wishes to contact us. If anyone's got any issues out there, if anything we discuss tonight, anyone's got a few doubts or fears about, get in touch with the Paranormal Chronicles, get in touch with me and Karen, and she'll email you. But we have to have a very, very fine balance between what is possibly dimensional, spiritual, demonic, angelic, paranormal, and what is mental health. Now, for me personally, I'm a very rational person. When I do an investigation, when I conduct an investigation, I want to know all environmental factors, all the conditions that may be causing this. I will go through a building with a fine-tooth comb and establish what I'm dealing with. 95% of the time, most investigations, we can find a cause. We can find a cause for cold spots. We can get a cause for feelings, noises, bangs, fuds. All of that can be explained. But now and again, we can't. So, unfortunately, some people in life, their life is quite mundane in terms of they don't feel their life is exciting enough. Maybe they got a job they don't particularly enjoy. Maybe they don't feel fulfilled in life. So what they do is, they, whether it's conscious or subconscious, is they create this element of I am special by having
excitement,
a ghost, having a demon. It's excitement.
Mm-hmm.
They want to feel, they don't want to feel ordinary. They want to have extraordinary things happening to them because they feel special. So maybe it's alien abduction. Maybe it's ghost, demonic, you know, and that ties in nicely with the ghost sex phenomenon that we'll discuss later. But you have to be very careful as an investigator. First thing, as an investigator, nobody should be going out there with a night vision camera screaming, show yourself. That is not an investigation. That's just somebody going out and pretending to be one. You want to interview your subjects. You want to do an analytical study of your building and environment. Find out what factors could be causing a possible haunting or what appears to be a haunting. But you want to sit down and interview the subjects, because what the last thing you want to do is, all investigators have a duty of care to their subjects. And what we have to do is establish if this person may have mental health issues, because if someone does have mental health issues, you don't want to fuel that fantasy of this happening by indulging with it and saying, oh yes, you've got ghosts, you've got this. So it's a really difficult fine line. So a lot of people who contact me, Karen will give them spiritual advice, but I always ask them to go and seek professional help as well. I always say, like, if it's mental conditions that have been affected, then I recommend they go and see a professional, such as a doctor or a psychologist. And then Karen offers the other side of the coin, which is spiritual advice and guidance.
Gavin, to what degree do you investigate? Do you incorporate all the bells and whistles, all the recorders, all the meters? From the chat room, Daria asked the question, does your guest have an opinion on EVP recording devices?
Yeah, definitely. We have, with myself, I go through the more scientific approach. We have all the equipment, night vision cameras, temperature readers. We've got the lot. And then Karen does the more spiritual practices. So between the pair of us, we can pretty much work out what's going on. Now, like, with the EVP recorders, very interesting. Again, what you need to do, you need to do control tests. So what I mean by that is, do a series of control tests in an area, do some recordings, and try and identify any background noises, anything that could appear to be voices or sound like a voice. Because pareidolia isn't just something you see, where you can make faces and see stuff. You can also hear it. We've all been like drying your hair with a hairdryer, and you think the phone is ringing, or you hear someone calling you. We've all had that experience. I've had and heard some fantastic EVP recordings. Whether they were hoaxed or not, I don't know. I've had my own in lockdown conditions where I've listened to stuff, and I'm like, good grief, that actually sounds like someone's there. So it's very difficult to establish, is there somebody in your area? Is it picking up some interference from, you know, like a taxi cab company, police, ambulance, airport, whatever? Or are you actually picking up voices of the dead? Now, I don't think it's impossible for, if a spirit has that amount of energy, to try and contact us. So I don't dismiss it at all. It's really interesting. It's really creepy when it's like 3 a.m. and you've got a big set of some headphones on, and you're listening and you're like, what did I just hear? Did I just hear something? You know, and then like, whoa. So I've had some spine chilling moments with EVPs, but yeah, definitely. I think that, you know, if you're doing an investigation, you should always record the proceedings anyway. Always try and get a good digital recorder and just record what's going on.
You gave us a few examples of some of the experiences you had throughout your life, and the fact that this book is about the accounts of other people. What is the most intense experience that pops out for you that you personally have had, though you may not be sure of it as far as coming to a conclusion of what it is or isn't? What would be such experience?
I think the most scared I've been, like some of the examples in the most haunted house really, really worried me. But, it was a very depressing, stressful time as it was. But the time that stands out the most was, there's a beautiful castle in Pembrokeshire called Pembroke Castle. It's huge. It's intact. It looks like something from Game of Thrones. It's amazing. If any of your listeners are ever in Wales, please go to Pembroke Castle. It's beautiful. Go online. If you go to the Paranormal Chronicles and you type in the Stinking Men, it will bring you to the article. Now, Pembroke Castle, I was very fortunate about 10 years ago to be able to conduct an investigation there with another group. The other group, they weren't my cup of tea in terms of, I wasn't a particularly big fan of their methods, but they did get us in the castle, so I wasn't going to complain. So they brought a load of psychic mediums with them, which again, I need a bit more thought and theory on that. I'm not entirely convinced. There are people out there who've got tremendous abilities and gifts, like Karen Williams, for example. Well, there's other people I think, you know, without sounding too controversial, might be in it for the money. And they might be making it up. But hey, that's just my opinion. No offense to anyone. So we went to this castle. There were some psychic mediums, and there's an old keep. It's like a few hundred feet high, this huge stone, cold, grey building. And we were conducting a seance in the inside, and it was pitch black in there. And on my right-hand side was my dear companion and fellow investigator, Gwyn Thomas. And on the left was a young lady from London called Emma. And we were in the circle, hand in hand. And the medium was doing her thing. And it was pitch black, and there was an awful smell, like really bad. And I thought, oh my God, somebody's farted, because that's a really bad smell. It's bad, like. And then I thought, God, I think they might have done more than that. Maybe, you know, maybe they need a change of underwear. And the smell was sickening. It was really stifling. And it was dark in this keep, but my night vision was starting to kick in, and I could make out stuff. And in the center of the circle, there were, say, 7-8 of us in a circle. In the center, you could see something black unfolding. And there was a figure of a man, maybe 5 foot. I'm only about 5'6", 5'7". It was short of an eye. And it started making its way through the circle. And the person next to me, this figure stood and stared into his face. And it was stinking. And my friend just gripped my hand so hard. I've never seen him frightened ever. Now, this thing moved and it stood in front of me. And I could just make out its face in front of mine, black and horrible. And it was most terrifying.
Did it have features? Did it have definitive features?
No features. It was just, you could see in the darkness. It was darker than the dark itself. You could see this figure of
darker,
a man.
Or, it was darker than the dark itself. So it was like a void of everything.
Yeah, so Imagine like what you can see when it's dark in terms of night. It was like a black silhouette, and it stunk. It was absolutely honking, as we say in Wales. It was absolutely disgusting. But it wasn't just the smell or this creepy vision of this silhouette in front of us. It was the feeling inside. And that's where I think a lot of people miss the point. It's not just about what you see and what you hear, but what you feel. And that's what I always try and do in my books, is to get my subjects to really, and in my reviews and in my reports online, is to get people to really talk about how they felt and bring them back to that moment. And this thing in front of me made me feel so dreadful, so alone, so ill. I felt like there was no tomorrow. It was like the deepest, darkest depression you could ever explore. It was awful. It was like, it was only how I could imagine what it must feel like for somebody on the verge of taking their own life. It was truly awful. But thankfully, this thing moved to the person next to me, and she squeezed my hand. And then a second one of these things appeared. And then the girl next to me ran, and the medium shouted, "Don't break the circle." And we all ran outside. And we all had the same experience. We all smelt the smell. We all saw these things. We all had the same feeling of dread and doubt and fear. And it was awful. Four of the people who were in the seance were so upset by what occurred, they went home. And I always had this nagging doubt. I don't know why. I've got nothing to substantiate this. It's just that weird feeling you get, that intuition, that whatever those things were have latched on to the people who went home, because they were awful. And I have been back. I've been back very recently to that very keep with all our equipment, all our stuff. And I went with Karen Williams as well. And nothing happened. It was absolutely no feeling. It was a lovely atmosphere. It was very disappointing in terms of any activity or it was awful. I wouldn't recommend it. But yeah, if you want to read the full story, go on to paranormalchronicles.com, and it's called The Stinking Men of Pembroke Castle. And it'll give you all the information about it and some photographs as well.
So this would be the classic case of shadow people. Would that be correct?
Yeah, shadow people. I've never seen... Now, a lot of the shadow people, like in a most haunted house, there were shadow people. But the shadow people that I have dealt with, reported and worked along, you know, investigating, they've always been more on the peripheral. Like, you can't look at them direct. You can see them from the corner of your eye, just lurking there, ever inching towards you. Now, these things were solid. They were solid, and they were very clear. They weren't a fuzz. They weren't just like an outline. These were solid. to the extent at one stage I actually thought, is there someone else in the room with us? Has somebody snuck in? That's how clear they were. Now, in a most haunted house, the first instance of a shadow person was a small object about 2 or 3 feet high that was making its way through the living room. And what it would do is it would slowly get closer to the people while they were watching TV over a period of about 2 weeks. It would start very in the distance by the kitchen, and it would slowly get braver and braver until eventually it did actually stand in front of the TV where it could be seen against the backdrop of the light. Now, the next door neighbours also had problems with a haunting as well, and their shadow figure they called the Angry Man, and he was 7 foot tall, and he used to come down the stairs and sit in a settee opposite him, which would have been terrifying. I never witnessed that. To be honest, I don't think I would want to witness that. But I think that the reason that we have these shadow beings is that our realm is such a thin veil between another dimension that possibly they cross over, or they come close to that veil, to that boundary, and then they appear in our dimension, which possibly could mean that we appear to other dimensions as shadow figures as well. So we might be haunting some people unintentionally as well.
Yeah, like the movie The Others.
I love that movie, and that really changed my opinion and everything. What's, you know, if there is a rip in time and space, then possibly we could be haunting each other from different times without realizing it. Because
if they can't actually see us in our full form and they're getting glimpses of us in our energies here and there, then of course it would appear frightening to them because they don't have enough detailed information to make any other judgment.
Exactly. And if you think about how many people have heard the story of, I was sat in my living room and a shadowy figure walked past me and went through the wall. And then you do some research and it turned out that there used to be a door where that wall was. Or a figure is seen walking, but it is submerged in the pavement, in the sidewalk, in the concrete or whatnot, because that figure is walking in the time where that path was different. The reason that figure is walking through the wall is because it's walking in its time. But for some reason, we get access to viewing. There's like a crossover between their time, space and dimension and ours. And they're walking through the living room, going through their door, but we cross over. Now, that we might be haunting them. While I'm just sitting on my sofa right, talking to you, somebody in my house 10 years in the past or future might hear this low mumbling voice, but it's me sat here now.
Understood. Very, very good point. An awesome way of seeing it, because, you know, you would take away time and space and you're left with now, and in the now is everything. I had a dear friend of mine who was an amazing psychic. I mean, Gavin, this guy was amazing. We had a mutual friend of ours who was having some complications in the house due to some shadow people. And he decided to do a psychic investigation. He walked through the house and he can feel the energy. And finally, he felt the presence in the room. He sits on the sofa and he pats his hand on the sofa, inviting the entity to come sit next to him. Basically with the idea of, come sit down next to me. Let's have a chat kind of thing. And he starts talking to this being. And he asked, what is your purpose? He says, well, if you believe everything is designed for you to make your way back home, synonymously God, he says, would you believe me if I told you we were agents of the light? He says, how do you say that? He says, well, because it is our job to scare you back.
Oh.
I thought it was a pretty good answer, actually.
That's really interesting. I've not heard that before.
And, you know, they may not be doing it intentionally if there's, you know, they may actually really want to scare the bejeebus out of you because that's who they are by nature. But still in all, the protocol and the reason maybe for their existence and creation of them would be, I mean, everything does serve a purpose for your higher good. Even those bad situations we sometimes have happen in life, there's a blessing in it. So maybe in that bad situation, that would be somewhat the blessing.
Exactly. Sometimes we have to have those moments where we crash, where we stare into the abyss, that we need those moments so that we can look and face the sun again and start to value and appreciate the life we have. Because of my dependency to alcohol, I kind of made quite a lot of errors and judgments in my life in terms of, you know, love, work, money. and I lost everything, and I had a nervous breakdown. And at the time, you know, I stared into the abyss. I had a terrible time. But then I came out of it, and my nervous breakdown suddenly became a spiritual awakening. And then now, because of the experiences I had of losing everything, I have a very comfortable life. I'm very blessed with the opportunities I've been given. I've worked very hard. I'm very focused. I'm determined. I've not drank in 3 years. And now I put value and appreciation on everything, from friends to having a cup of tea or a shower in the morning. You put great value, and you put that into life, and you become more open and aware of other people. Now, I spoke to an Italian doctor after the publication of Ghost Sector Violation, and he said what he believes is happening is the reason these spirits, these dimensional beings, demons, whatever people wish to call them, the reason they latch onto us, the reason that they create so much misery, depression, fear, anxiety, all the bad stuff, is that because they want to break us. They want to latch onto us and drain us of all the positivity, all the good things, all the things we care about. Because if we give up the fight and we commit suicide, which is sadly, we all know people that this has happened to, that their soul are forfeit. And he believes that there is literally a battle for our souls, that our souls are actually a commodity. Now, I don't know how real that is, but I thought it was a very interesting theory. So we talk about guardian angels and fairy godmothers, and those are spirits and or dimensional beings, whatever you want to call them, but come here to try and help us, to boost us, to lift us up, to put us on the right path so that our soul can carry on. But at the same time, things we call demonic, they come into our reality, they latch onto us, and they cause dependency, drug abuse, prostitution, gambling, all this terrible stuff to try and break us.
So in your book, Ghost Sex, The Violation, those who may have children, maybe you can have them go play in another room. We're going to keep it very light on the lingo. What are some of the cases that you have documented surrounding this particular activity?
Well, after the success of A Most Haunted House, I was so blessed that the book was so well received, and commercially and critically, and the feedback. It was just a fantastic event to happen in my life, being dyslexic and all of these kind of things, that people are like, what are you going to do next? And I was like, wow, that's a really good question. So my plan was to write about my original subject, which was imaginary friends. So I put a call out there through the Paranormal Chronicles, through a few of my avenues to connect to people, saying about, you know, I'm looking to do an investigation and a book about imaginary friends. I met a wonderful lady who was in her 40s from a town not far from where I live. And we started talking about it. And when she was young, her and her twin sister had an imaginary friend called the Naughty Boy. And he turned out he wasn't that imaginary at all. He might have actually been a spirit. So I got talking to it. Lovely lady, very interesting. And then one day she divulged to me, and it was like I'd been hit in the head with a sledgehammer, that she'd been sexually abused by not one, but two paranormal entities for over 20 years. Wow. And suddenly my interest in the paranormal became a lot darker. It was a very, very difficult book to write. We spent about 2 months together. The book, Ghost Sex Violation, in hindsight, Keith, if I'm honest with you, I wish I'd called it something else, because it sounds very sensationalized. It's my mistake. I wrote it. I didn't think people would be that interested as it was. The controversy that followed the book was so intense. I had death threats. I wasn't responsible for the raping. I just reported it. And, you know, the woman whose book is the story is based on, she's contactable in terms of, if anybody out there has had a similar experience, you can send me an email. I'll send it to her. She's trying to create a focus group, a support group rather, for people. She believes this is a very real condition. Now, what happened to her was that she had a young son, she had a broken home, she was pregnant when she was about 16. The father did a runner, left her on her own. Her mum was a very spiritual woman, and she helped daughter raise a child, and they, as these things do, there was hauntings. The book is in their words, again, like a most haunted house, ghost sex violation is in their words. It's not my words. It's very raw. It's very gritty. It's the language they use, not the language I chose to use. So if people are offended by the way the book is presented, don't be. I'd rather you read their words than a glossed over version. That's how they presented it. And it's terrifying. They believed there was one very dark entity who'd be heralded by a terrible smell, which is a common theme, which was really interesting because the stinking man of Pembroke Castle had the same kind of smell. And the other one was just cold. It was a cold feeling, and she'd wake up and there would be a coldness on her, and this thing would work its way up her body. It would perform foreplay upon her. It would have sex with her, unwanted sex. And now, obviously, my main rationale for that was that maybe it was sleep paralysis. There's a number of different sleeping disorders, psychological reasons, anxieties that can cause this. So anyone who is listening to this and you've had this experience, first of all, don't panic. There are rational explanations. If you don't believe in irrational explanations and you're a bit scared, please contact me and I'll put you in touch with Karen Williams, and she'll have a chat with you as well. She'll email you and she'll help you. It's all for free. Now, the other entity...
Let me ask you this. Oh, by the way, listening audience, 888-919-2355. 888-919-2355 is the number. You call in to speak to myself or my guest, Mr. Gavin Davies. Let me ask you this. First of all, is she still having an experience?
Yes.
These kinds of okay. My thought is, as spiritualists, we understand that we create our own experience. We draw to us that which we put out. That being said, have you found any connections, not necessarily with her, let's take the view of her, we don't want it to be about her, anyone who are having these sexual attacks, having some unresolved sexual emotions in their life due to some past experience they may have had in their childhood upbringing that keeps causing this manifestation in their life as such?
Yeah, most definitely. That was the first thing I asked Lisa in the book was, it's an awful question to ask, but was there any history of abuse or trauma growing up? I have dozens of reports of people from like 6'6", 280-pound men from Philadelphia, you know, big horses, to, you know, a former policewoman. Some of it, I believe, is manifested through, maybe guilt.
Subconscious,
not saying it was their fault, but they feel guilty and they manifest it. Some of it could be like they're reliving sexual abuse. The most common thing on my website is people search for, and get this now, this is really insane, Keith. This is the most common thing on my website, right? Over 320,000 people have visited my website. The most common thing is, how do I get a ghost or demon to have sex with me?
As in a desire?
A desire, a want, a need. And I'm just...
Wow.
And now, don't get me wrong. I don't want to sound like too arrogant, but there's 7 billion people on the planet. There is someone for you. I don't care what you look like, how you are. There is someone out there. In my day, you had to go out, meet a girl in a pub, and get her phone number. People don't even have to leave the house anymore to meet people. There's all dating sites and all these apps. You know, we're in the world is very small. There's 7 billion people out there. You can find people. Worst case scenario, if you're that inept at finding someone, I'm sure, not that I'm condoning this sort of behavior, you could pay for it. You don't want to welcome or herald some kind of demon or spirit into your life. Psychologically and physically, it's not very good for you. But that's what people want. And it's really terrifying that people want this. Now, if you read Ghost Sex Violation, what happens to Lisa is the other entity has, I'll be very careful what I say here because I don't offend anyone, but very graphic, brutal, punishing intercourse, if you can call that. It sodomizes her in a brutal, barbaric, inhuman fashion with her. Now, people have likened this account to the entity, the Doris Biver case. This is not like this at all. This is beyond brutal and gritty. Anyone out there thinking, oh, this is 50 Shades of Ghost, a bit of titillation, you know, I'm going to have a read of this, I'm going to enjoy it. You're not going to enjoy it. It's grim, it's brutal, it's shocking. There's certain parts of the book which just stop people dead. His son was involved as well. Stuff is happening to him. It's really awful. And the fact that people want this in their life is just really concerning to me, because if you could summon something, I don't think you'd want to bring any kind of darkness into your life. I personally believe, and again, I'm sorry if I upset anyone with this, I believe that it is psychological. I think there are reasons for this. There's all sorts of things. There's something called sexsomnia, where people have sex in their sleep. It's actually been used in a court of law in a rape case, but sexsomnia is something that happens. I know people who said they wake up at night and they're having sex with each other because their bodies are just doing it naturally. You know, that doesn't mean there's a spirit or a ghost or a dimensional being taking control of their lives.
Sure. Wow, Gavin, I'm trying to take all this in.
It's a bit shocking, isn't it?
I don't disbelieve. In fact, I absolutely believe. It's just hearing it again and bringing it to the surface of my conscious mind is just boggling to the level of I don't ever use this word evil, negative energy, negative beings who actually have the ability to punch there. I wouldn't so much say that. I don't think that they're invasive in the sense that they're making their way through, boring their way through like a piece of wood, like a worm would do. But I think it's more the fact that there's an opening that they can climb through, and they will use that orifice to their advantage to whatever degree to keep you in fear so they can have nourishment and get their jollies off as well. I mean, what else do you do on the other side in the land of the dark? I don't know.
Well, like a lot of people have read Ghost Sex Violation. Again, it was a big commercial hit. It really polarized readers. It was two camps. Either they thought it was really important investigation or they hated it. As again, I don't take it personally. You know, if you own Kindle Prime, you can borrow it for free. You know, it doesn't, you know, it's not about money for me. It's about getting the word out there and getting people interested in the subject. The more of us talking, thinking about spiritual things, paranormal things, the better. It's a great subject. Now, with Ghost Sex Violation, people said they started to pick up that they don't believe it was two spirits at all. What it was, there was a spirit who was the cold man, and then an incubus, which was the degrading, punishing. Because if anybody wants to, I'm not here to sell the book. If anybody wants to read the book, you can. But if you're a bit unsure, just go to the paranormalchronicles.com, go to the page that says Ghost Sex, and there's samples of the book, interviews with the lady, psychological reports, all the stuff on them. So you can get a good grasp of what went on in the book. Obviously, it hasn't got the crazy detailed stuff because I'll probably get the website shut down. But they were talking about that there's an incubus, and that in the book, actually, at some weird point in the book, the incubus and the spirit seem to have a face-off. And there's an energy charge in the room, there's orbs, there's light seen. The sun is pressed against the wall while he's watching his mum being degraded in humiliating sexual fashion. And he's vomiting on himself and his mum is soiling herself. Absolutely dreadful, dreadful condition. And to sit opposite this woman and interview her, she's lovely. She's a lovely woman. She didn't want any money for the book. She hasn't used her real name. She hasn't gone on any talk shows, any radio shows. All she's wanted is if anyone has got any similar experiences to send their experiences to her and she can try and like, help and guide them. Mm. Either this woman, I brought a psychologist with me. The psychologist believes that whatever Lisa believes happened, she believes is true. And that doesn't mean that it happened, but what it means is psychologically, Lisa believes this is happening to her. Whether it's hallucinations, whether, you know, I did some tests with her. She doesn't do drugs. She has the odd glass of wine. The psychologist did some tests with her. And, you know, for all intents and purposes, this is a sane woman. But her son, who is 24, he was reading a pornographic magazine on his own in his bedroom when the ghost hit him and threw the magazine across the road, across the room. Now, when I sat with a family, what kind of family would sit there, son, mother, and grandmother, and sit in a room and say, do you know what? Let's hoax the most graphic, sexually depraved ghost story ever. What kind of family would do that? So I've spent a lot of time with body language, micro-expression, all of these things to try and get to know my subjects a little closer. And for all intents and purposes, the mother was telling the truth.
What would the family... Why are they letting a young child look at a pornographic magazine in the first place?
He was 18 at the time.
Oh, he was 18 at the time. I see.
He was 18 at the time.
Let me ask you this, Gavin. In your life, since you do so much work surrounding this subject in the field, and I'm sure you probably even take it home with you to some level. You might dismiss it, but I'm sure you're probably always working on some level about a story you're about to catch up on, or one that reminds you that you learned about it 2 years ago. Do you find that the fact that you're submerged in this work, do you bring it home with you, meaning it? Do you find some of that stuff coming into your house where you live now, or just little things that are happening that because you're so involved?
When I was writing Go Sex the Violation, mentally, I brought a lot of it home with me, and it actually cost me two relationships in terms of how do you go home and make love to someone you care for when you've been immersed in all this brutal, gritty, depraved sexual, you know, this awful, awful thing. But in terms of actually bringing it home, I'm very blessed that I get to work with Karen Williams. She's my creative and spiritual muse. She's really good on hand. She keeps an eye on me in terms of she makes sure I'm always protected, always blessed. And to be honest, I can disconnect from it. I don't want to sound like I have too much bravado, but I don't really get scared by anything. In terms of, as my dad said, the living will do you more harm. A home invasion or a burglar will probably cause you more fear and spirits. It's just that initial confusion and shock. Karen's done some experiments on me with my spirituality and opening my chakras, and I've had some really scary experiences that I couldn't explain at the time. And she's teaching me because I'm quite closed off. I don't have any gifts. I can't see dead people. I can't speak to dead people. And I don't proclaim to have any gifts or abilities. Karen has fantastic gifts and abilities that I can't explain.
Well, maybe we need to get her on Center of Light Radio at some point.
Well, I said that to her tonight. I asked
Here's your invitation,
her to join
Karen.
Us. Yeah, Karen will be listening. I said to her possibly about coming on tonight, and she was like, "Oh, you know, it's a bit sudden and stuff." So maybe me and Karen can pop on at a time convenient to you, and you can have a chat with Karen because we do a lot of work together. We do the Pembrokeshire road trips, the haunted road trips. We've done many investigations together. We're currently working on a lot of investigations. We have a huge archive of stories, myths, legends, plus her own personal experience. She's an incredibly talented person, and you know, I'm not a manager or anything. I don't get a cut or anything, but if anybody out there has any problems or need spiritual advice and guidance, maybe a bit upset about some of the things I've said tonight, just get in touch with her. Go to the paranormalchronicles.com website. There's a link to me, G L Davies. There's a link to Karen, where you can just send a general inquiry. We will get back to you and we will help you. We will, wherever you are in the world, whatever your background is, as Karen said earlier, it doesn't matter what religion you are, spirituality is here for all of us. And, you know, and we can all work together to resolve in some of these issues.
I've always talked about, play with the idea of in the future of opening up a paranormal investigation. I'm not really frightened by it. I don't doubt that some things that I might experience in that field would take me back in the spontaneous of something manifesting or happening in front of my face. But I think I'm very strong. Not only strong, that's not the right word. I think I'm grounded as a spiritualist enough to know that though it is very real, seemingly real at least, what helped me was to know from my experience as a spiritualist that it's just an illusion. And it would be more for me to find my way within myself to find the connectivity, my real self, to be able to diagnose or be able to stay in the presence of what's happening so I could be of assistance. Basically what I'm saying is the paranormal, though it may spook me, it doesn't frighten me.
No, not at all. It's fascinating. Do you know what
Absolutely.
I mean? It's a pseudoscience. You know, what if we could understand? What if there were rifts in time and space and dimensions? What if things can cross over? What if there are negative energies and positive energies and shadow beings and black-eyed kids and aliens and Loch Ness monsters? What an interesting world it'll be. You know, we're all into Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter and Game of Thrones, these magical worlds. Maybe our world is more magical than we realize. Maybe it is more spiritual. Maybe we've just forgotten because we submerse ourselves in lives of earning money, going to work, you know, getting the kids to school, paying the bills, watching TV and films and movies. Maybe we've just forgotten the magic. It's all around us all the time. You've got to think, we're very suggestive people. We're brought up believing in Father Christmas, Easter bunnies, the whole idea of God, you know, is a very wondrous and miraculous thing. The most, you know, no offense intended, it's actually like a really strong endorsement. The most paranormal text you could ever read is the Bible. It's amazing stuff, miracles right. happening in the book. But we dismiss it. So anyone who's a religious person already has an inkling that the paranormal exists. Life after death, heaven and hell, reincarnation. It's all there. We've only been on the planet a small amount of time. We're a speck of sand on a beach in terms of the grand scheme of stuff. 500 years ago, we believed that the world was flat. In 500 years' time, what will we believe in then?
They'd kill you if you thought otherwise.
One of the biggest crimes, like a legacy we have to behold, is that we used to burn witches. Because it didn't fit in well with what religion had at the time. We used to burn witches. And think if we hadn't burnt those witches, how far advanced we would have been in medicine, with herbs, with nature, with spirituality, with mental health. It was all there, and we crushed it. You know, and it's nice to see Wiccans and witches and pagans and all now. You know, people say it's evil and all. It's not evil. It's just people trying to make sense of the world they live in. Whatever religion, whatever philosophy you are, if you're trying to make sense of your world, you're doing the right thing.
You know, Gavin, I believe it's all real. I believe it's all true. You know, where are these thoughts coming from about ghosts? Where are these thoughts coming from about aliens? You know, if we're thinking about this in our very finite minds and in this skull that we have, you know, the universe has entertained the idea many a times. And if that's the case, the likeliness of it being real is pretty phenomenal. Gavin, we are at the closing of the show. Would you like to leave us with a final thought? We've got about another minute.
Well, Nietzsche said that the curse of man is that we were stuck between ape and God. You know, we're a very complex being in terms of we're animal, but we're also very spiritual. And the world is an amazing place. You know, you don't have to have money to travel it. We have our minds, spirituality, meeting other people, learning of other people's experiences. And that's what I recommend to everyone. Do some research. Have a think. Get in touch with people like me. Listen to radio shows like this. It's a wondrous universe. Don't become a slave to TV and your video games and your iPads and stuff like that. Read a book. Start thinking of what's out there. Go on investigation. You know, enjoy your life. It's an amazing place.
Gavin Davies, thank you very much for joining me here on Center of Light Radio. You're welcome back, sir. Bring Karen with you.
You're a wonderful man. Thank you so much. I look forward very much to coming back. You're a brilliant bloke. Thank you.
Thank you, my friend. Be well. Everyone, Mr. Gavin Davies, what a great show. Next week, my guest is going to be Winter Lake, and we're going to be talking about psychism and remote viewing. What two fantastic subjects and are favorites of mine. Happy holidays to you. Monday night, Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Spread the word and spread the light. Power up. It happens on Monday night. Remember, when you breathe at night, laying down in your bed, breathe as if you want something magical, something paranormal. And you'll see that your life will change just by connecting with your real self. Keith Blanchard, see you next week, Monday night, 6 p.m. Peace, love, and light to you. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas.